What is going on, everybody? It's Stas here. Welcome back to another video. So in this video, we're going to be doing another market update, taking a look at the Dow Jones, the S&P 500, and the NASDAQ. We're going to be talking about two trades that I made today on the 4th of April in 2019, as well as taking a look at Tesla and whether or not I'm looking to swing trade it. Did I already buy shares? We're going to be talking about that in today's video, as well as taking a look at some other stocks and ETFs that I'm personally watching here in the month of April in 2019. But before we do get into all of these topics, guys, all I ask from you, if you enjoy this video, if you find value in any of the content that I produce on YouTube, is feel free to go down below and hit that like button. It really supports me and supports the channel in general. And if you're new to the channel, I have two links down below, one of them being the Discord group chat and the other one being the Facebook group. Both of those are 100% free of charge, and I guarantee you guys, you'll find value in those platforms if you go down below and join them. So without further ado, let's talk about what ended up happening today on the 4th of April in the overall stock market here, starting off with the SPX, the S&P 500 index, the 500 largest publicly traded U.S. companies. We ended up closing the day up $5.99, nearly $6 on this index, up about 0.2%. The Dow Jones actually had a very strong day today, up 0.64%, up $166.50 at the close. And the NASDAQ composite here, guys, it's down about $19.50 right now, down about 0.26%. But remember, this is the future. So if we go in here a little bit closer, we can see exactly where we ended up closing at about 4 o'clock. And it is roughly around this range. So we can say we ended up closing the day red, about 0.2% in the NASDAQ. So in terms of the S&P and the NASDAQ, it really wasn't a crazy day, right? Mostly a consolidation day for these two major indexes. And if we hop over here to get a better understanding of the S&P, some supports, resistances, and the technicals, you know, we've been talking about how this 2860 old resistance has been acting as a new support. And if you guys watch my videos from earlier this week, literally on Monday and Tuesday, I was talking about how since we pushed up to a higher high in the SPX, there was a high likelihood that we were going to consolidate at some point this week, right? And if we hop over here to the 5-day, 5-minute chart, we can see, guys, pretty much we've been consolidating really since the 2nd of April, which was on Tuesday, right? We consolidated, we popped up here, but really we pushed back down and consolidated a bit at that same support. We pushed up today, and then we ended up testing that same level again and pretty much consolidated around the same area of about 2870 to 2880. And really, my theory for Monday and Tuesday has been playing out. And really, why I talked about that earlier this week and why I thought about, hey, we might consolidate this week, is because every single time, just take a look at these technicals here, guys, every single time that we push to a higher high in the S&P 500 over the past couple of months, really, we've peaked, consolidated for a little bit, and we either A, popped up to a new level, to a new high, or B, we ended up pulling back a bit and seeing a 2, 3, 4% retracement in the index, right? And this is nothing different. We popped up, we broke to a higher high, we were maintaining that level here at 2860 as a new support, and we've been seeing some consolidation. So for tomorrow and for next week, what I'm really going to be watching for is, are we going to continue this consolidation? Are we going to potentially start to pull back and see that 2, 3, 4% retracement? Or are we going to level up to the next higher high in terms of the S&P 500. So that is what I'm watching here, guys. Very simple. Again, nothing much to touch on because the technicals have really been the same for this entire week. So I don't want to spend too much time on, saying this because it's like beating a dead horse, right? It's like me repeating myself, over and over again. But the Dow Jones here, we actually broke a very critical resistance that we've been talking about. And that level is at $26,200. So take a look at this, guys, right? 26,200 resistance back in the beginning of November 2018. We topped off at the same spot towards the end of February in 2019, about a month and some change ago. And the past couple of days until today, we've been really seeing resistance and consolidating right under that resistance, the same spot at 26,200. But today, we had that very strong green day finally pushing us out of that level. And it's looking like we're testing an old support now from back in September of 2018, which is the next resistance we need to break out of before we slowly start to potentially test, these high levels of nearly $27,000, which just happens to be an all-time high in the Dow Jones. So for tomorrow, guys, very simple, right? Are we going to pull back and maybe maintain 26,200 as a new support? Are we going to break this level? We're really in a tight little horizontal gap right here. If I zoom in, really it's from 26,200 up to 26,400. So that's a very tight window. And really tomorrow, we're going to see what direction we want to head in, whether or not we break out of this resistance, we pull back down to test the support. These are things that I'm going to be watching for to determine the direction of the Dow Jones Industrial Average. So hopping back over here to the NASDAQ composite, guys, we are looking like we're testing and maintaining the new support at around 7,500, although we did see this pullback. And yesterday, I think it was yesterday or the day before, I was talking about how I want to see the NASDAQ really pull back and test the support, which was a new or older resistance at 7,500. And that's what it's looking like is happening, right? And the thing that I'm actually noticing here on the NASDAQ, guys, is since we popped up to about 7,600 a couple of days ago, the RSI was extremely overbought, right? It was at about 80. And for those of you guys that don't know, if an RSI is at 80, that means it's extremely, extremely overbought. But since we've pulled back 100 points or 50, 60 points, whatever it is, the RSI has pulled back to a healthy range, really to about 57 to 60, which is a little bit overbought still, but it's more healthy. It's a healthier range than the 80 range. And this is telling me, based off an RSI standpoint that, okay, maybe since this, we pulled back here, we're maintaining the support. The RSI pulled back again. We're seeing a green bar here towards the close of the market on the 184-hour chart, or really not towards the close of the market today, really over, let's say, the past day. This could end up pushing back up tomorrow. So just keep an eye on that. And of course, we're getting close to those all-time highs, guys. I'll say the next resistance is at about 7,600, 7,630-ish. We can see a double top here back in the month of September on the NASDAQ. And if I drag that out a bit, we can see that just happens to be roughly where we got topped off a couple of days ago. So it seems like we are in this little horizontal pattern here on the NASDAQ. So just keep an eye on those levels. And another thing to mention here in terms of the RSI, guys, is the S&P, and the Dow Jones, they are both pretty overbought on their RSI level. So does that mean that a pullback is 100% going to come? No, it doesn't mean that, right? Because we've talked about how the RSI, don't just use one indicator to make your decisions, right? You have to use a couple in unison. But if we're just taking a look at the RSI, hey, maybe we might see a pullback here just off the RSI. But again, you got to use a couple in unison with some fundamental analysis and take a look at the whole picture, right? You don't want to just base your decision on one thing, RSI, the MACD, even though the MACD is not here. You guys understand what I'm saying, right? So let's just talk about what I ended up doing today in terms of my trading. So the first ETF I traded was a gold-based ETF. And we saw JNUG, which is actually what I traded, went absolutely off the walls today. And we saw a reversal that I was honestly not expecting, right? And for those of you guys that don't know, JNUG is actually a bull ETF that trades based upon the gold futures. Whenever gold's going up, JNUG is going up as well, right? And we saw JNUG over the past couple of days, really, we've been consolidating around this $9 support level. And this morning, we took a pretty big dip down to about 870. We gapped down from about 920 at the close yesterday, down all the way to about 870. So that's a 50 cent move, which in an under $10 stock or an ETF, guys, that's a pretty sizable move, right? 50 cents in a $9, an $8 ETF. That's a sizable move. So we gapped down pretty heavily. And honestly, at this point in time, guys, I wasn't watching JNUG at all. If you guys watched my video this morning, I was actually talking about JDST because gold was actually at about 1288, something like that. But then gold went on this insane pushback, which helped JNUG go absolutely crazy. And I actually set an alert. Thankfully, I set an alert on JNUG at about $9. I wanted to be alerted if we were to get a reversal to the upside on JNUG. And that's actually how I caught this aggressive move that we saw, right? And if we just hop over here to gold very quickly so we can see the big move that we did see. You know, take a look at this, guys. This is a typical, you know, big sell-off and a typical gap fill here on gold. We sold off from 1296 down to about 1284 at the open of the market. That's about a 12-point drop. And from there, we made this V pattern and we really recovered all of those gains. This is kind of like an inverse head and shoulders type of pattern here. You see the left, head, right? We pretty much made that full move all the way back up to pre-market, really not pre-market, like the resistance levels that we saw from last night. And this is where, you know, I ended up taking my position. Again, I had a little alert on JNUG. I wasn't watching this one closely, but once I saw this bullish move on gold, the 50 SMA crossing the 180 SMA, this was pretty big in my eyes as a reversal. And I ended up putting in some money in JNUG roughly at about 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And if we're hopping back over here to JNUG, we can see at about 11 o'clock, this is when we ended up pulling back. We tested that $9 level of support, and we bounced right off of that. And again, from the GC chart, that's when we saw the bullish cross on gold. And if we're looking back here again, the support on JNUG was at about $9. So this was all, you know, a couple of different things that I was seeing in unison that were pointing to a bullish move in gold. I ended up putting some money roughly at about, I believe, like $9.10, 9.05 or something like that. And if we hop back over here, we can see, you know, roughly at about 9.10, I think it was 9.11, ended up putting in some money in JNUG and actually ended up holding this one for an hour and a half, 2 hours. This was a bit of a longer trade due to the uptrend really just holding itself, right? We were pulling back higher lows, higher highs. You know, we were maintaining the 50 simple moving average. Gold was pushing up very nicely. So I felt comfortable from 9.10 up to 9.30 to hold JNUG. And we can see if we just zoom it up, guys, I made about a 2.1% profit simply for holding JNUG for about an hour and a half to 2 hours. So that was actually the only day trade that I ended up taking today. And it kind of sucks because honestly, guys, if I were to hold the entire day, you know, I typically don't try and beat myself up for these types of things because I'm more of a conservative trader. I like locking in profits. I'm all about being consistent. But let's just say hypothetically, I ended up holding the entire day here, which, you know, it's not really, it's kind of against what I do in terms of day trading. I like being in and out in like an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, sometimes even less, you know, 10, 20, 30 minutes. But if I were to hold, I would have made about 7% on my money, which is very, very solid for one day. you know, for a one-day day trade, right? So that's what I ended up doing today in terms of JNUG. So now let's talk about the other trade, which I'm sure you guys probably kind of, you know, guessed this from the title of the video. Yes, I ended up buying a couple of shares here of Tesla today. And for those of you guys that want to know more in depth of what happened to Tesla, go check out the morning video. But the gist of it, guys, very brief gist here in this video, Tesla ended up falling today due to the deliveries really being short of analysts' expectations, right? I forget exactly the number off the top of my head, but I think they were expecting about 55,000 Model 3s. Only 50,000 Model 3s got delivered, so that was about a 7-8% less than expected from the analysts. And we saw the stock price fall like a falling knife, right? It fell like crazy this morning. We ended up closing the day yesterday, or we were at about 296 at some point yesterday, and we fell all the way to 260, guys. So that's nearly a 40-point drop overnight in Tesla stock. And to be honest, guys, I've been telling myself over these past couple of days, next pullback that Tesla has, I'm looking to start building a swing position, right? And I'm actually already long invested in Tesla in terms of having a long position. For those of you guys that watched my video like a month ago or something, I ended up buying some Tesla shares at about, off the top of my head right now, I don't really remember. I think it was like 272, 273, something like that. And that's in my long-term portfolio. But in my swing portfolio, I was telling myself, I want to start building a position for maybe a 2-3-4 month swing trade in Tesla next time it drops. And hey, we got that today, guys. We got that today. And what really opened my eyes here on a technical basis, is the fact that we ended up holding this downwards, channel support here. We can see we ended up bouncing here once in the past, twice, three times. A couple weeks ago, we ended up holding once, twice. We dipped a bit below it to 255, but ended up recovering nicely and pushing back up. And the fact that we ended up bouncing here at 260 today, literally right at that support channel, that gave me incentive and honestly, the incentive, to buy some shares of Tesla here for a swing trade. And I'm going in this trade with the mentality of, if the stock goes down, maybe we retest 250, I'm okay with buying more at that price, averaging down. Because let me explain why, right? Typically when I'm doing swing trades, especially swing trades where I'm looking out on a 2-3 month basis, I'm looking to scale into my positions, right? I'm not looking to hop in. Let's say my goal position is $10,000, right? I'm not looking to hop in with all $10,000 right off the bat. I'm looking to scale in with, let's say, $2,000, right? And then add more if the stock goes up, and maybe if the stock goes down, evaluate the situation. If we're holding long-term supports, even if the stock goes down, let's say we break a support, but we're maintaining the next support, I'll evaluate the situation and I'll be like, okay, maybe this is a good time to add some more money. And then I'll add another $2,000, right? This is something that I call scaling into your positions. It's nothing new. I'm not Einstein. I didn't invent this. This is something that's been around in the trading community. A lot of people that do long-term investing, you've heard average cost, dollar cost averaging. It's the same thing, right? But this is more of a shorter term perspective here, because this is a shorter term swing trade. And the whole idea of averaging in, guys, is let's say you put in your initial 20% of your goal, 100% position, and the stock tanks 10% and you want to cut your losses. Okay, you're not going to lose as much money as you would have lost if you went in all the way with that full 100% position right off the bat, right? So I honestly ended up getting in to Tesla this morning, on this initial little pullback at about 265. Bought a couple of shares here, and I'm very comfortable with holding these shares with a mental stop loss here over the next couple of weeks. And again, if we end up breaking supports, I'm going to evaluate the situation and maybe buy some more shares. And of course, I'll keep you all updated. So all in all, guys, I'm not too worried about what happened with Tesla today. We've been getting some signs and some news that 2019 was not going to be the best year for the company. But still, on a longer term basis here, in terms of these charts, in terms of these technicals, guys, we can see Tesla's highs were 376 rather. And down here at 266 on a technical basis here, you know, this is a pretty good buying opportunity in my personal opinion. And I'm taking advantage of it, and I'm fully willing to take this risk. So let me know down below in the comment section, what do you guys think about this? I would love to know what your opinions are. Did you buy some Tesla today? Are you swinging the stock? Let me know down below in the comment section. So very briefly today, guys, before I do end off this video, let's just go through some stocks rapid fire. So Tesla, I'm not going to talk about it again. This is one that I'm looking to trade. I kind of already broke it down. This is on my list of the top three or four that I'm currently looking to trade. So crude oil, I talk about this one a lot. Crude oil right now does seem like it wants to pull back, right? We're seeing kind of a bearish move here on the 5-day, 5-minute. We're noticing the top at 63, lower high at about 62, and we honestly double topped here, which for those of you all that don't know, a double top could, you know, signify or signal rather that we're heading down in a stock ETF index or a future, just like a double bottom could signify or signal that we're going up, right? So take a look at this. We're seeing a bearish cross here in terms of the 50 crossing below the 180 SMA. So keep an eye tomorrow on crude oil. If we do end up pulling down to $61.50, maybe $61.30, which is the previous resistance, now a new support, that's going to be an interesting spot to reevaluate the situation. Are we going to hold that level? Maybe pop back up from there, slowly start to uptrend back from there. That could be a good entry point for UWT, which goes up whenever crude oil is going up. So I'm keeping an eye on this one tomorrow very, very closely. And another one that I feel like a lot of people have not been talking about, and I haven't been talking about, honestly, has been Boeing stock, guys. Take a look at this reversal on Boeing stock. I think I talked about it a couple of videos ago, maybe in the top stocks I'm trading in April video. I talked about this, or maybe a video before that or the week before that. But nonetheless, Boeing, we all know what happened, right? The 737 crash that really crashed the stock itself down to about 366. And from there, we've been seeing some nice reversal, reversal patterns in terms of Boeing. And now we're being tested by this 180 simple moving average resistance here, as well as the 395 resistance here from back in the beginning of October in 2018. So this is a level where if we break out of this level, you know, we could be pushing back up to mid 450s, maybe 415. So just keep an eye on this next level that we could potentially be getting to. And if we break out of these two resistance levels and we confirm it, that offers about a 5% margin in terms of Boeing, ticker symbol BA, stock. So that's one super, super interesting in my eyes right now. Facebook is one, again, that we're kind of seeing some resistance at the level of about 177, 178. See, I'm watching tomorrow to see, are we going to end up testing back higher here, maybe 177, 178? And eventually, are we going to break 180 to then potentially go back up to 186? So from 180 up to 186, that's about a 4 or 5% margin on Facebook. I think this is very possible with the beautiful reversal pattern that we are seeing here on the 180-day for our chart. In terms of Apple, I've been getting a bunch of questions on Apple today. It seems like Apple's been really struggling. Actually, not struggling, but just maintaining the 195 level as a new support. So Apple, you know, we could easily see Apple back up to $200 in a couple of days if we do end up breaking up into the 196, 197 level. So keep an eye on this one. This could be a quote-unquote safer swing trade, but really, do your research, guys. You know, no stock is safe out there, but if I were to say a stock is, you know, a swing trade is quote-unquote safer than another, I would say Apple is safer than, let's say, Tesla, right? And I'm sure a lot of you guys out there would probably agree with that. So those are just a couple of stocks and ETFs that I'm watching heading into tomorrow. I hope you guys did enjoy this video. If you did, feel free to drop a like, leave a comment, and subscribe to the channel. If you have any questions for me, feel free to follow me on Instagram and shoot me a DM. And of course, on Discord, you can message me as well. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. I appreciate all of you guys out there for watching. I'll catch you all in the next video. We'll chat in the Discord and on Instagram. Peace out, guys.